core agenda of the program is. Please be enjoy the section. It's not like our regular classroom. You have to take the notes or anything. Try to watch and observe the images and carefully hear it. And you can post your questions once I finish my talk. So we will ready to discuss it. The agenda of the meeting is where the chemistry and physics meets the biology, because it's an interdisciplinary science basically. So we are trying to connect chemistry, physics, and biology together. And what is called the fluorescent probing technique? Why we have to probe? And what are fluorescent probes? What is the physical chemistry behind the fluorescent molecules? And how to image the fluorescent molecule? And what kind of equipment we are using, like the microscope? There are different microscope family members we are going to see. Again, it's a very huge area. I can go by intro part and the application only. I can't go very detailed in any of the other occasions. We can discuss about the different techniques in a very detailed manner. Here we started from the light microscopy technique only, not with electron microscopy. So I can give a small idea about the electron chiromicroscope at the last. But we will start from wide field, confocal, light sheet microscopy, and structural illumination microscopy, and stochastic optical reconstruction microscopy, that is called as STROM. These are the advanced super resolution techniques. I hope a lot of them know that. Some of them don't know. If they don't know, please enjoy the course. And if you know, you will get some more points also from this webinar. So here, first we can start from what is biophysical chemistry. Because we know about the physical chemistry, almost a lot of physics students and chemistry students are there. What is mean by the biophysical chemistry? The physics is the most fascinating area in the science. Everyone know that. So once you are trying to apply the physics on chemistry, for example, you put the light on any chemical molecules, then you will study the molecule work or the function or the dynamic or the structure. It's called as physical chemistry. Once you pass through the light through any of the biological specimens, okay, and try to get the biological information, you call that it's a biophysics. So you are trying to measure how the biomolecule is rotating, what is the size, what is the order. Basically, this combination of the field is called the biochemistry. So we are trying to apply the physics on the biochemistry background. So overall output, we concentrate on the biophysical chemistry. So trying to understand the biomolecules by using advanced physical chemistry techniques. That's the concept of the whole course idea. So once you can see here, where we can meet the chemistry and physics in biology. You know cells, I hope a lot of them are biology students, some of them not, but you know, here you can see the biological cell. So the biological cell has different kind of molecules, cytoplasm, nucleus, DNA, mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, different things are there. So the people want to study the structure of it, how it is structured, how it is assembled. Now we know this COVID virus, you know, the COVID virus size is around 120 nanometer in size. How they invented it and how they were, how they understand the structure of these viruses. So once you know the structure or the geometry of the molecule, you will understand the function of the molecule. Okay. So then what are the dynamics behind it? So the dynamics in the sense is the rotational dynamics or the translational dynamics or a diffusion or otherwise how speed it can rotate and how it can diffuse it, or any other chemical transition states are there, depend upon the pH or the ionic strength or the energetic pathway. So all these parts can basically called as the physical chemistry, and which is applied for to understand the biomolecule. So it's called as biophysical chemistry. So the basic idea is usually the people go and understand the structure of the molecule, because once they know the geometry and the assembly and the order of the molecule, they can easily claim the function. So the function is in the two different category. One is the biomolecule, another one is the biophysical. In the biomolecule, you have chemical or the biological functions. Another one in the biophysical, you have the mechanical or the thermodynamical functions. So today we are going to see more on biophysical mode to understand how the mechanical functions, how the structure was there, how the intracellular protein structure was changing. What are the alterations due to the unconditional state like cancer or any other viral interactions. So like this kind of different application we are going to see. So to understand, to apply this biophysical meaning, to understand this, what kind of techniques, how you can probe it, how you can understand it. Just to visualize this, this picture, this is an illumination of the cell. The cell is like a factory, and it is a great puzzle in the world. Everything made up of cells. The cells has n number of molecules, nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi, lysosomes, cytosol, cytoskeleton, lipid traps, peroxisomes, and plasma junction, and mitochondria, nuclear envelope. So people want to see how these molecules are, how they are arranged. In the live condition, how these molecules are working. So they want to, if you want to probe anything, if you want to trace anything, what you will do? You can attach some light on the head of the person and put it in the dark box. And you can see where, you can watch the person where he is going. You tell he is in the left side corner. He is in the center. The same approach we are trying to use here. We are trying to tag some light on the molecules. That tagging or attaching the light, that light is called fluorescence. Almost a lot of chemistry and physics students know about the fluorescence. So here you can see there are various images. So these images are all made up of attached with the fluorescent tags, fluorescent chemical molecules under the microscope. So they can pass through the light, it can emit the light. So we can visualize, we can capture the image and reconstruct the image, then we can visualize it. So this is the basic idea. So now, what are the fluorescent molecules? How we are going to visualize it? In what resolution we are going to do? This is the whole story of the whole talk actually. Okay. So first we can start with light matter interactions. We know that once the light is passed or light is started interacting, once it can scatter and it can give diffraction, reflection, refraction, that's separate. Another one main phenomenon is it can absorb it. It's like a ground. If you put the water, it can absorb the same light. The light can absorb it any molecules. So once it's absorbed and started, it can blooming out. It can emit that. That emission is characterized by fluorescence and phosphorescence. Fluorescence is happen within nanosecond time, and phosphorescence can happen. It's in the microsecond. It's called a delayed fluorescence. So once you are analyzing the spectral property of this component, the spectral information, you will find it, how the molecule is, what is the structure of the molecule, how the molecule can respond, what are the spectral properties. Today, we were start with the basic fundamentals of the fluorescence. Once the photon is absorbed, it's in the ground state. You can see there are S0 is the ground state, and S1 and S2, the higher excited state. Once the photons are absorbed by the molecule in the ground state, it can go and excited into the theoretical states of S1 or S2 state. And after the vibrating, after the energy relaxation, it started coming down from the S1 state to the down state. Like if someone will hit, we will get angry. Then after the meantime, then we will decrease our anger. So the same process. So once we were exciting and getting back again, and we can start emitting, if you can emit something. So that emission is in the light waves. So usually the emission are all in the longer wavelength compared to the absorption. If you absorb with 500 nanometer, you will emit it around 560 nanometer. So usually this is the thumb rule in fluorescence is like that. The same kind in phosphorescence also, and it is a delayed fluorescence. It's in the microsecond. We are not going to discuss about the phosphorescence today, but we will think about more on the fluorescence, how the fluorescence is acting. And what are the important factors can affect the fluorescence? I think someone of them has raised the hand. Hope you can ask the question once I finish the talk. I hope you can understand. Is it okay, or you want to answer me now?
No, sir, it's okay. Actually, we will have an interaction session. Definitely, we will have it. So it is better to ask the questions for the participants. Please, you better ask the questions at the end of the talk. Thank you.
So, what are the factors can affect the fluorescence? The viscosity, the pH, the ion extent. So there are different processes can affect the fluorescence emission. So depend upon the intracellular environment or the microenvironment, the fluorescence spectra can be determined. So here, what the fluorescent molecule once it can excite. Once the molecule can excite, first it will emit. There is an interconversion or intermolecular charge transfer, or it can change the conformation or electron transfer, or it can transfer the proton, or energy transfer, or excimer formation, XC plus, or the photochemical transformation. These are the basics of the photochemistry of the excited state molecules. So once the vibration is decreased, then it can start coming down. So at that time, the relaxation state will be increased. Within that relaxation time, we can find these different variations. Here, there are some of the basic concepts. Once the fluorescent molecule is there, it has the absorption value, the maximum absorption. For example, the GFP, that is a kind of bioluminescent protein, it has the absorption value of 488 nanometer. The emission will be at 510 nanometer. Under quantum yield, how much photons it can absorb, how it can give. And what is the excited state lifetime? How much time it can stable in the excited state? So it should be nanosecond in the case of fluorescence. So these are the basic behavior of the fluorescence and their photostability. And it should be easily detectable and how fast it can last its ability. So these are the different types of fluorescent information which is there once you select your fluorescent molecule. Here, now we can start with the basic transition moments of the molecule. Everyone know about the naphthalene and anthracene and the pyrene and pyrifin. These are the basic fluorescent molecules. It can absorb it at around 280 nanometer and it can emit it later on. But before that, it can select the optical path. If you are passing the vertical light or the horizontal light, you can see the direction of the arrow mark. So the molecule should be accepted. The atom should be accepted that and can go for the emission excited state. So this is the detailed explanation of the absorption. Hope in the second talk, you will see more detail about this kind of absorption values in the photochemical part. So that there are the type of fluorescence. We can start with the amino acid based fluorescence because we are going to discuss about the proteins here. So the basic fluorescent, intracellular fluorescence are all in the, all proteins are tryptophan, tyrosine and phenylalanine. These are the basic fluorescent molecules which is available in all the proteins basically. You can take any protein, you can find the tryptophan, tyrosine or phenylalanine in a different concentration. So what the people will do, they will excite the tryptophan or tyrosine and the phenylalanine in the UV region. Then they will try to calculate the concentration of protein. This is the basic experiment on fluorescence the people will do usually. There are other intracellular fluorescent molecules are available in the cell. It's called as NADH, FAD or the pyridoxine phosphate. These are the natural fluorescent molecules is available in the mitochondria. So this will emit in the concerned wavelength that's called as autofluorescence. So depend upon the NAD and FAD concentration and the transition, people identify in which biological state the cells are. So these are the intracellular fluorescent molecule which is available. There are synthesized or extrinsic fluorescent molecule. This is familiarly available in almost all the labs, the fluorescent. So the excitation is at 490 and the emission is at 520 nanometer. And body P and the cascade blue and lucifer yellow and rhodamine. So these are the basic dyes you can see in all the laboratories. The people can use these dyes for the fluorescent purpose. So there are some special dyes. They are available to use for the membrane studies. You know, this is an artificial lipid membrane. Once you put the fluorescent PE, it has a very long chain. It can go and bind to the lipid in all the directions, like this in vertical and horizontal direction. Once you apply the fluorescent light in the polarized direction of like 90 degree or 45 degrees, so you can excite only the zone. So I did it in my microscope, so I can show this in my images. By using this way, you can understand how the membrane lipids are arranged in the cells. So the fluorescent molecule is not only the tracer, and it is a very, very important tool to understand the intracellular behavior. So nowadays, the latest development, we need a fabulous molecule which can stable for such a long time and with a very low bleaching value with a very high quantum yield. Still now, almost all the chemists are trying to develop this kind of molecules, and nowadays there are upper conversion, quantum dots, there are different types of molecules are available. So the people can concentrate to develop this kind of very important fluorescent molecule which can be useful for to understand the biological reactions or the biomolecular function. The common molecule everyone know about, that ethidium bromide, it's one of the very toxic molecule, and DAPI. These are the main molecules can be to see the DNA. You can see the image. This is the DNA is the gel. So usually in all the biotechnology, people know about the ethidium bromide, which can bind the intercalator. It can go and bind to the DNA. Once you pass through the UV light, you can emit it. So this is the ethidium bromide homodimer formation. And there are other dyes called a DAPI and HOST. So these are the quite common used fluorescent dyes used for the biological molecules to localize the nucleus. So we understand, okay, this is the size of the nucleus and the other part is the cytoplasm. So this is the way the people can identify that or tracing or probing the biological molecules inside the cell. Now we can, these are the chemical fluorescence what I discussed with you. The important thing is the biological fluorescence. The Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2008, name is Osamu Shimamoto from Japan, who went to the US and he found the jelly . So he extracted the protein from the jellyfish membrane. He identified the protein looks fluorescence and it's giving light. Then later on, the other scientist Chevely, Martin Chevely, who were cloned this protein to the bacteria and visualized the bacteria under the microscope, and he found the bacteria looks green in color. So he told that, yes, there is a molecule we can use for our to visualize the intracellular environment, that is called GFP, that is green fluorescent protein. There is another very interesting case, is a chemistry, his name is Arrow. What he did, he changed the structural alterations in the protein by inducing the mutations. He changed the chromophore functions. Then he identified different colors in the VivGR. So from green, red, blue, cyan, and all the colors he invented. So then they used for the different biological purpose to identify and localize the biomolecules. Still now, this is a very breaking out invention in biology. All the modern biology they are using to visualize the protein by using the GFP family only. So these three scientists got a Nobel Prize in 2008 for inventing the green fluorescent protein and the spectral properties. So that's why the fluorescence entered to the biological area. It has a very strong value. You can see the structure of the GFP protein here. So GFP is a very intelligent architecture. You can see there are 21 beta pleated sheets are covered like a barrel. It's like a barrel. It's like a tube barrel. The chromophore is hanging in the center, which contains tryptophan and serine and glycine. So this is the main chromophore. Once the light is absorbed, then it can have the transition rearrangement. And finally, the chromophore will give the green color flow, the green color emission. So at 507 or 510 nanometer. So you can see the absorption and the emission profile of the wild type green fluorescent protein at 488 and 507 nanometer of emission profile. So this is the common green fluorescent protein. So people are using in a lot of biological application. Here you can see the various images with the green fluorescent and other proteins. You can see the people can identify the neurons by tagging the green fluorescent protein, neuron structure, and with the mitochondria, or endoplasmic reticulum, or the cytoskeleton. So there are different types of applications the people are doing. How they will do this application, how they are doing it. So then we need to go to the microscope, how we can image this fluorescent protein, which is tagged with any biological molecules. That's the main question. So now there is another type of, another tag is called as quantum dots. So the quantum dots is a small fluorescent molecule which is tagged with the protein or peptide code with that. So it has the multiple colors it can give. So it can absorb in one and emit in the other way. So this is one of the very latest and updated in the chemistry field. The people are using quantum dots because it has a very high quantum efficiency with the lifetime also. So but in some of the quantum dots are quite toxic to the cells. So but now with the nanoparticle synthesis or upper conversion nanoparticles, so these are the recent advancement in the chemistry. We have to really thank to the advanced chemistry section to understand the biomolecule function by using this kind of tracer molecules. So now we know all the fluorescent molecules. How we are going to image these fluorescent molecules? By using the equipment. We need to image it. We have the fluorescent molecule in the tube. What we are going to do, how we are going to attach and image. For attaching process or the biomolecule reaction between the chemical molecules and the fluorescent molecule and the biomolecule can be explained in the next section, quite detailed with your mechanisms. But I'm concentrating on how we are going to image it. everyone has interest because our eye resolution is 0.1 mm only. So we can visualize our hair, not more than that. So if more than that you want to visualize, you need a lens, the proper lens. You want to magnify the system because our eye don't have the ability to visualize it. So for greater magnification, we can use the lens that's called as microscope. That is the place to resolve the things, to magnify the things. Once you are resolving by any lenses or the combination of lenses or designed by lenses, the process, what you are doing is called the microscope. So you, in the micro level, you are doing by scoping it. So here, the term resolution is born. So how the resolution is going to defend it? We know that resolution means clarity. Yes, resolution means the clarity. So we want the higher resolution one. We want to generate or collecting more amount of photons from a small source. You can see some object. You want to excite that object. You want to pass the light on that and try to capture it and collect more amount of light from that. So by the way, you can understand what the objective, what the object is doing inside or under the light. So by using the light and by using the chroma, and we are going to use the optics to fine tune and focus and try to get how the microscope, how the image is going to form. So here you can see the famous formula from the scientist called Karl Abe from Germany. He told that the resolution limit of the microscope is 250 nanometer. Whatever the microscope you're using with the light microscopy, the resolution limit in XY direction is 250 nanometer. That is 0.25 micrometer. That's called the diffraction. So here, this is a famous equation. This is depend upon the wavelength and the numerical aperture. So the numerical aperture is the amount of light, how much you are collecting, and the wavelength, what you are using, in which wavelength you are using. These two parameters can determine your resolution. And within the optical range, the diffraction limit is lambda by 2 sine theta. So how much of light you are going to collect it. So if you are going to collect more light, but the diffraction barrier never change. But later on, it changed. And field it opened, that's called a super resolution microscope. We are going to see in the second part of the section. So for this, we need a very high numerical aperture. Now we can, I take you to the section of the microscope. We know we have a fluorescent molecule. How we are going to see the fluorescent molecule? This is an equipment called microscope. I hope some of them know, someone don't know that. But still, I want to explain the thing. There are different parts of the microscope. This is called the inverted microscope. The light is coming from the down direction. This is the light, but this is the coming direction. You have the objective here from the down. So this is the stage. You can put your sample in this place. The light can pass through and capture by the image here. Okay. So within this region, you see this part, the light is illuminating in your sample. This amount of volume, what you are illuminating is called as the excitation volume or a confocal volume or a point spread function. So please understand this part. It depends upon excitation volume. You are going to change your technique or you are going to get or you are going to excise manner. Will explain you the resolution. So this is this confocal volume. This is the place where you will put your samples. So the complex molecule can travel there by the Brownian motion. So the total number, the total volume of this excited volume, you can see this. This is the fluorescein, and you go to the detector. Photon. I'm not going to concentrate two photon. Keep it away. But with the wide field, this is a basic microscope available in almost lot of laboratories. We can use a white light, the LED light, what you are using. You can use white light here. This white light is passing through objectives and going to your sample and getting back again and illuminating. You can see there are the amount of light can be passed through to your sample is in a very large volume. Okay. So this is called a wide field. And then you can generate the image here. And later on, the invention came with the confocal. The term confocal means you are precising your excitation. Not to excite the whole sample, you are precising the amount of light what you are passing through to the sample is very, very less by using the pinholes. So this is the another kind of technique is called confocal. And within the excitation, the people changed with the higher and pulsed lasers, then you are passing through the light in a femtoliter condition, that is called 10 to the power of minus 10 liters of the confocal volume. So this is called the two photon. So by understanding this diagram, we understand we change the light. Here the beam of light is the LED light or white light, but here is the laser light. And again, here also the laser, but the amount of excitation volume is much lesser compared to the white field by avoiding the phototoxicity or otherwise to avoiding the bleaching condition to save your microphone and try to collect only the specific amount of photons, not all the one. Okay. So now here I can introduce our microscope. That's the FlowView 3000. It's one of the high sensitive and most powerful confocal microscope in the world. So we are the one who is dealing in India. So I'm the one who is using this microscope regularly. I can explain how this microscope can be applied for a variety of applications. Now you can see here, I make a sample. The sample is for example, the yeast. You know, every one of them know the yeast. It can use for the bread preparation. We can make a sandwich of yeast and put it into the cover slip and pass the light on this. This light, this area we are going to excite, the small amount of volume which I'm indicating here, this area will generate the whole image. So within this image, we know we are tagged with the GFP. This is cytoplasm, nucleus, vacuole, and everything we identify. And within this small area, we can identify the different kind of applications. This is a very interesting part. You can see the regular wide field microscopy and the confocal microscopy image. Watch these two images carefully. You can see the confocal image is much better than the wide field image because we are using the very precise light that's called the lasers. The lasers can help to give the photons what you are collecting, blue, red, and green color. So everything corresponds to the different fluorophores with a different emission wavelength. We'll see in the next slides. One of the main application of the antibodies, this is the mouse brain. They can slice the mouse brain and they were attached with the GFP or axaflor or the homoflor antibodies with the different wavelength and they imaged it under the microscope. You can see by using this 1.25x magnified microscope with the objective, you can capture the full image, and once you zoom, you can see all the. So this is the single neuron image. You can see the dendrites in the synaptic marker with the green under the 10. We use the 10x objective with a very high numerical aperture. So can be understood or captured by the fluorescent microscopy techniques. This is one of the advanced fluorescent microscopy techniques. Is confocal microscopy. Second one big advantage information is this microscope limits kind of biological understanding. If your molecule is not happy, if your molecule is not with good quantum yield, or the absorption and the emission is not proper, and it is not stable, if it is phototoxic, you can't use it. So the chemist is the main funda brain of this part. You can attach the fluorescent molecule, the appropriate fluorescent molecule. Then we can use the light from physics. We can get the light with a different kind of laser light. And with advanced optics, we can try to image to understand the biological functions. So this is the light sheet microscopy. Now, we know about now the confocal and the light sheet microscopy. Now we are starting about what is the maximum spatial resolution limit can be achieved by the microscope technique. As I told you, the microscope can visualize up to 250 nanometer in the previous range. So, but later on, you can see the mouse is 10 centimeter, brain and ant, hair, cells, and bacteria and viruses and protein, and you can go to the molecular range. Like still now, X-ray crystallography and NMR is the most prominent technique for to identify the structure of molecules in the nanometer or in the angstrom range. But now the electron cryomicroscopy is developed really well. But still, if you want to identify any chemical structure, you have to go to NMR or to X-ray crystallography. If it's a powder or otherwise like liquid crystals, whatever, that's the only way you can do it. But still now the microscopy reached into that limit to break everything. But with the light microscopy, you can go up to only 10 nanometer. But very recently, they climbed with the 2 to 3 nanometer, you can see. But still, it is not very sharp to all the laboratories can start to use that. But you can go up to 10 nanometer by using the technique called super resolution technique. You can, I indicated here, these are all the super resolution technique. So this kind of super resolution technique is a very advanced fluorescent microscope technique. We are going to see in the next section. So first we will start with the how much of light we can collect by the microscope. So the heart of the microscope is called objective. So objective is the material which is local, which is the one who can pass the light through to the sample and collect the light from the same direction. So how much of light you are going to collect, that's called as numerical aperture. You have the high numerical aperture, you will collect more light. So that's depend upon your wavelength and the angle what you are using, that is called mu or theta, sometimes people use it. So within this angle, the cone of light is passed through to your microscope and you can go with your lenses and you will image it. So I don't want to go with optics at this moment. So this is the basic idea. Now you can see here, I'm asking you, every one of them, you can see the difference between these two images. The image which is indicated by SIM, the term SIM, structured illumination microscopy, looks better than the wide field. I imaged the HeLa cells, which is tagged with the nuclear pore complex, means the gateway to enter to the nucleus. The blue color is the nucleus, and the small dots are all the nuclear pore complex. It is like a small holes in the nuclear membrane. That's called as nuclear pores, basically. So within this nuclear pores, we can tag with the two different proteins, because the nuclear pore contain different protein. I'll show in the next slides. So you can see the difference between these two. Here in the wide field, by using the wide field, you can't see anything. you can't resolve anything. But in the case of SIM, yes, you can resolve how many nuclear pores are there, how it is separated, is it near or far. So these all the things can be resolved by using the super resolution technique. This is the greatest revolutionary thing in the modern microscopy. So now we can talk about the diffraction barrier. As I told you, the diffraction barrier is in the X-ray direction, you can go up to only 250 nanometer. There are the three famous scientists, Eric Betchik and Stephen W. Hell and William Morimer, who got the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for 2014. Please understand, I shown only the chemistry Nobel Prizes, but still they are all using the biology. They are all using the high intensity lights, but they got the prizes in chemistry because chemistry is the basic platform for doing all these techniques. So here you can see the three guys, three of them are most prominent researchers. And Stephen Hell is the one who invented a SCED technique. That's called the localization microscope technique. And Eric Betchik is one of the phenomenal scientists from the Bell Laboratories. And he made his microscope from the home itself. Then he got the recognition later on. Now he's a big shot professor in US. He's the one who invented the polarization based structural illumination technique, what I shown you before. So you can see, compared to the conventional microscope, we reach to the resolution to clarify and see molecule by molecule. So these are the three gentlemen who developed the technique and capture these kind of applications. So the Nobel committee got the Nobel Prize for these three scientists to invention for the super resolution fluorescent microscopy techniques. So before going to the fluorescent techniques, we can see about our resolution limit, or the spatial resolution limit. With the confocal microscope, you can go only with 120 nanometer in the XY direction, and with the Y and the X zeta direction, you can go 340 nanometer. So this is the total, this much of amount of light you will pass. This is your point spread function or a confocal volume, what you are using it. But in the case of SIM, you can go up to 120 nanometer. Compared to that 200 nanometer, now we are 10 times lower than that. Then with the zeta direction, we can go up to 280 nanometer or the 250 nanometer. Then with the Palmer storm, we can go up to 30 nanometer in XY direction. You can see like around the, more than 10 times, we are very low to precise to localize our molecules and understand the structural function of it. Okay. So this is the Palmer storm techniques. So we are going to discuss about this techniques in a detailed manner. Now we can start with structural illumination microscopy. As I show you the structured light, the term structured illumination means it's a structured light. Structured light in the sense you are passing the light which is structured. It is framed or it is designed to pass through your sample. The basic principle of structured illumination is we have that we are passing the light with the five different angles and faces in the x y direction. So we are cutting the sample, we are cutting the light in a different direction to pass through and collect the images in different direction and reconstruct the images by using the mathematical algorithm. So we are using the fringes called as Mori fringes. Basically it is like a polarizing fringes. So these fringes were allot us with the different faces and we can reconstruct it to achieve the resolution. This is a, so the lateral resolution in the XY direction is 100 nanometer. In axial resolution is 250 nanometer. I did recently, I worked and published the papers in this technique. I can go with the different applications to show the power of the technique. So this is the one mechanism what we found very recently with the nuclear pore complex. We know the nucleus. The nucleus has the pores. These are the pores. It's called nuclear pore complex. Okay. So what we did is this nuclear pore complex has multiple proteins, and it is like a gateway for all kind of reactions. But still now it is the bottleneck for the biological research. How the nuclear pores are sending the samples or the proteins outside. There are a lot of hypotheses different researchers are doing. But still it is a fascinating topic in advanced molecular biological research. So the people are doing it in a different direction. We were trying to understand the viral protein complex S, that is VPX from the simian virus, how the virus protein is passing through to the nucleus by using this nuclear pore complex. That is our question. So it is to understand, it is like a basketball. So the nuclear pore complex is like a basketball net. If you put the basketball go through to the net and pass through. The same thing which is happened like a nuclear pore complex. The nuclear pore complex structure is like that. There are more than 30 different kind of proteins are attached here. So we tagged this protein with the fluorescent dye and try to image by using the microscope. So we are using this time the structural illumination microscope to understand how the protein molecules or how the nuclear pore complex is arranged. You can see here this picture. This is the green fluorescent protein fluorescent molecule and the red color is the nuclear pore complex. In the 3D direction, how it can go. So this is the video. Just you can carefully watch. This is in the 3D direction only. It's not like a live one, but you can see the protein is diffusing through to the nucleus membrane. So this is captured by the microscope only. Again, this green and red color are the dyes. One is the bioluminescent GFP. The green color is the GFP and red color is the dye. So here you can see. We can projected this in the super resolution. The blue color is the nucleus and the red color is the nuclear pore complex and green color is the protein. So within the different Z direction, we found that the molecule is attached or otherwise co-localized with the nuclear pore complex and passing through to the sample. So this idea is the main one. So the VPX protein is a viral protein, which is attached that's in green color. The red color is the nuclear NUP, that is nuclear pore complex protein 153, which is attached with the red color dye. So we can image this and see how this can be projected through. So I am just showing this in the three-dimensional direction. We imaged it and we found that it is like a funneling type. So the molecule is in the big, and while it go inside, it can penetrate through in a linear direction and pass through the thing. And recently we published this article in the Molecular Biology of Cell Research, and my image got selected in the poster also. So it shows that the VPX is a cargo protein and it can pass through to the nucleopore complex. So this is the way we can try to understand how the viral protein are passing through to attach with the nucleus and disease. So this is one of the very fabulous image what we found it. This nuclear pore complex proteins are all ruptured in the nuclear membrane. You can see this is ordered in this direction. In the left hand side you can see it is ordered, but in the right hand side this aggregate, the protein aggregates are started rupturing. So this image got selected actually for the image. So we are so proud for that. So this is the way how the super resolution can work. Another one is with the cancer cells. We know that cancer cells are a very tedious one. So we found that a lot of cancer cells show the nuclear membrane morphology alteration, that is a bubble formation, or otherwise some kind of rupture and everything. So these are all identified by using the super resolution technique only. So you can visualize here all kind of the super resolution part. You can see the nucleus bubble formations happen with a lot of cancer cells as well. And this is with the viral protein again. It can attach with the nucleus and squeeze the nucleus by pushing through to all the direction. So we are trying to find in three-dimensional direction how these viral proteins are attaching it. And this is the HIV-dependent protein actually. So that is called VPR protein. So it is HIV virus-based protein. So it is overexpressed to the nucleus and squeezed out all the genetic material out from that. So these are the basic idea. And the third one application is the autophagy. Autophagy is a programmed cell death. Still now the autophagy is happened with a very tedious cellular environment that we know very well. So this autophagy can be imaged by using our three-dimensional SIM technique, structural illumination microscopy technique, with the three different colors of dyes. The green color is one dye, red is one dye, and blue is another dye. So these three dyes were co-localized in this, and we do the 3D imaging. So you can see here how the autophagy can be changed in the different direction. So, and the last one is the actin protein. Actin is a protein we can use for the cellular structures, that is cytoskeleton structures. So here you can see in the cancer cells, the structure can be altered or it can be ruptured. But with the regular cells, you can see it is ordered really like a bundles of things. But in the case of cancer cells or the overexpression of some X protein, like cancerous protein, it is ruptured. So this kind of the very minute structural alterations or the cellular structural chemistry can be used to this kind of fluorescent acts. So all the colors what you are looking are all the fluorescent acts only. So this is the basic of the structured illumination technique. By the polarization, we are achieving the super resolution. The second concept what we are seeing is trying to blinking or on off a specific molecule. So not with the special molecules. We are just blinking these molecules. So by on off or switching these molecules, we were reconstructing the image, which is called the stochastic optical reconstruction microscopy or photo activation localization microscopy. So which is giving much more better than the confocal or with the SIM resolution. This is around 10 nanometer or like 20 nanometer. You can resolve all the structural details. So this is one of the other advanced techniques. So here for this condition, you have to switch on and switch off. That's called a photo conversion process. So isofluorescent protein is a kind of reversible green fluorescent protein. So you can switch off in some condition. You can excite with 405 nanometer and switching on. Again, once you stop, it can start illuminating with that corresponding wavelength. So here you can see the photoactivable range of things. So this kind of special dyes, photo switchable dyes, were invented by the chemist. And this kind of photo switchable dyes can allow us to go for the deeper resolution. So again, the chemical molecules, how utilizing listed in image are involved for localizing a single molecule. So within the very high decision by fitting the point spread function by the Gaussian. So the point spread function within the wide field fluorescence microscope is superimposed with the wireframe representation of the pixel array from a digital camera. So these are things are all the theoretical one which is happened inside the microscope or in the camera. Just to show you how this can be happen. So you have to collect the photons and you have to reconstruct the data in the Gaussian function to do your image. So this is the basic idea. You can go to 30 nanometer in XY direction compared to the previous one is 10 times much more stronger. It actually is 40 nanometer. So here is one of the very recent nuclear pore complex image. We imaged with the STOMP technique. You can see here it is 100 nanometer of resolution. So we are collecting n number of photons. So again, it is the photon statistics. You will collect more amount of photons and into the Gaussian fit, you can reconstruct the image. So again, these are the very special dyes we use with the special buffers with the specific pH range. Then only this can use the photo switchable to on and off and to reconstruct the image data. Otherwise, we can't achieve this data. And it is a very tedious process to develop these techniques. And we did it with some nuclear pore complex. I want to share some of the interesting pages in the microscopy. So this can be used for the students. You can go and check these web pages. So to understand the latest basics and as well as the advancement. And in YouTube also, you can go for the iBiology program to the microscopy series. Lot of experts can give the details. And one of the very fascinating web page for me is the Nobel Prize web page. Almost lot the it's a lot of scientists out here. They like this. So you can go and access this web page. You will get plenty of information and in the basic level from the inventors itself. So you can use these web pages as a student point of view. It's very important. There are some two books. If you want, I can share some of the ebooks also. Very important ebooks to the students. I can give it to the department. You can collect from them. And at the last, I have to thank to the DSS. And we are the hub for all the microscoping, all the microscope techniques. Now you can see. I discuss all the confocal, wide field, the spinning disk or super resolution, different kind of techniques. So we are the company who are dealing all this microscope to the advanced research centers. So if any one of them are interested about to learn or to know about these techniques, please be in touch with us. And my email ID is everything is available with the College of Hope. If you need any more details, please feel free to ask the question. And we are the one who is dealing with spinning disk and light sheet and the D-Strom palm. And very latest, we are working with a very high throughput scanning electron microscope. It is not a regular microscope. It is a very high throughput scanning electron and it is 30 times faster than the regular scanning electron microscope. You can go for a very bulk brain imaging and everything in a very high resolution. So these are the things from DSS, what we were doing. Hope you will enjoy this lecture. Thank you for the questions.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
It's been really a colorful and a very knowledgeable presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
We had a deep insight into imaging technology, sir. You started sure. from the very basic thing, and we traveled along with you to a very advanced technique, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Dear participants, this is the time to interact with our resource person, Dr. I. Sebastian Raja. If you have any queries, please post it in the chat box. I will read the question on your behalf and the resource person would be delighted to answer to your questions.
Yes. Someone has raised the hand, maybe you can.
Yeah.
I think a couple of them are raising. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll give some time.
Yes, yes, please. Please.
The participants, you are asking the PPT of the resource person, but we have a YouTube video. So you can, and I have sent you the link, YouTube live stream link, and you can subscribe it and you can watch it anytime. So the video, PPT will not be available, but the video of this presentation will be available in YouTube.
Sure.
That is a question, sir, from Dr.
Yes,
M. Sir. Chitra.
Yes, ma'am.
Just a minute, I will read it out.
Please, ma'am.
Sir, can you tell more about the toxicity of quantum dots and how it can be overcome?
Yes, the quantum dots is again a very important, fascinating area in the research. In quantum dots, once you go with the quantum dots, we have a different wavelength. It can absorb in one wavelength, and the emission profile is totally different from that. And second one disadvantage still now with the quantum dots is the toxicity. So the quantum dots as now they are called as upper conversion nanoparticles. Very recently, I found the details. We have a seminar from that also. So if you go and check with that upper conversion nanoparticles, you will get quite more precise detail about the quantum dots, because it's a wide topic again. I don't want to go in a very detailed manner for that. Okay.
Yeah, there is another question from Mr. Tamilwanan.
Please.
What is the size of nucleopore complex?
That's a very interesting question. So again, the size of the nucleopore complex is in the two directions. I hope I can post this. I can show you. Yes, you can see here there are the people were trying to identify the size till now. The electron cryomicroscopy can explain that the diameter within the range is around 60 or 50 nanometer in the different directions. But the total size from top to bottom,
cytosol,
still now is not that really well. Because the size of the molecule is very big. With electron cryomicroscopy, they are trying to get the molecules, but still all the molecules is not packed really well. So the usual diameter from different labs, they were identified with 120 nanometer. Or like 50 nanometer of the size, but we are not sure if this is, because once you are identified this bottleneck question, I hope you will reach the Nobel Prize too, because it's one of the $1 million question anyway. But still, no, it's not yet clear. But it's a very good question.
Yes, and there is another interesting question, sir. With these various techniques, why can't we solve COVID-19?
It's an open question, but still I can answer you. You know about the bacteria and virus, okay? The bacteria, the mechanism of bacteria is totally different from virus. Virus can be stable anywhere, okay, in air, anywhere, like a simple protein core. And if you want to multiply the virus, you need a cell, okay? So if the virus is entered to the cell by throwing the nuclear pore complex or anything, it will integrate with your genome and taking your cell as his host. So if you want to kill the virus, you want to put the drug to your cell only. So if you kill the virus, you are killing your cell also. This is the greatest bottleneck in the virology still now, in the case of HIV and all the way. But if you want to solve any disease, for example, paracetamol, the molecule everyone know, for the invention of paracetamol and it can come to the market, it takes minimum 20 to 25 years with all the tests, everything. But within a year or so, you can close the COVID means it's not possible. Still, there are some vaccines are trying to save us not to be affected. But once it's affected, you want to cure it. It is a question mark. Not even for our cough, we don't have proper drug in the world. Still now. You can see the cough. Everyone gets the cough from birth till the death. You can stop the cough, but you can't cure the cough. So this is the same thing in the case of COVID also. Okay. Ma'am?
Yes, there is another person who wants to interact with you. I am a zoologist, so I need to take historical section of an part.
Okay.
Can we monitor the movable tags, sir?
Historical section means, please understand, please explain me about your sample.
Mr. Tamilwanan, can you please rewrite your question so that we can understand the question properly?
Is it that tissue sample?
Maybe we will move to the another question, then let us wait for him to come
please,
back.
Please.
Is microspectroscopy can be used to find the chemical constituents?
Oh, yes, of course. Why not? Which kind of constituent do you want? See, for example, if you have any dye, you can take any dye. Okay. You want to understand the basic reaction of the dye, you can put under the microscope. and you can see the functional or the spectroscopic properties. I hope the next talk will detail about the spectral properties of a chemical molecule. You have some chemical molecule. You want to know about the function of the molecule, you need to see the structure of the molecule. Okay. So by passing through the light, you will get the structural data, like the spectral data, like the fluorescent lifetime or the photon intensity or like the quantum yield and the diffusion coefficient, everything you can measure by the different techniques like FRET, FCS, like anisotropy technique to see the rotation and correlation time, everything. So by the way, you will understand how the chemical molecule. But at the same time, if you want to attach this molecule with react with another molecule, then the reaction state will change or the transition stage will change. By understanding the fluorescent spectra of the of these two molecules, you will identify the chemical reactions. That's called as chemical kinetics or the fluorescent kinetics, which is quite famous with all the ultra-fast process of the physical chemistry. I hope Dr. Pradeep can explain you some parts in that.
Okay. So the previous questioner,
yes,
histology is part.
Yes. Now, in the case of histology, there are two things. One is the dead cells, like the if you cut your tissue and you keep the tissue as such it is, and stain it with the Hamsa stain or whatever, you can do the micro time, and then you will fix it and you will see. There you will see how the molecules are. That's it. But you want to work with the live tissues. Nowadays there are a lot of techniques are available, that are special techniques. You can use the techniques and incubate with a specific buffer with the live tissues. You can work there. You can find, but you need a very advanced microscope equipment or cameras to identify and localize that. Yes, you can do it. Nowadays, the tissue biology is allowing us. Yes, you can.
Okay.
And if you can see, there are that SCID microscopy or otherwise with a lot of microscopy. Nowadays, people are using the live mouse also. They will take a live mice and keep under the microscope and passing the dye through that and focus that and to go for the emission and see what the neurons are doing in the head. So that's the advancement we have. So you can work with the neurons or this thing with light microscopy, light sheet, everything you do. Yes, you can. Another one.
Another question. Will the same dye molecule will have same kind of emission when binding with different biomolecules?
Yes, it's a very good question. Usually, if you can see with GFP, we can take a GFP. Okay, GFP is like one of the basic light source or the basic tracer or probe molecule to tag with the n number of molecules. Okay. But you are tagging the protein and you want to image it. Yes, you can collect the 5-10 nanometer, no problem. But you want to see the intracellular environment. Like, for example, if you attach with mitochondria, the mitochondria has NADH, FAD, and other molecules, and that also gives the autofluorescence. And you are going to analyze the spectral information or a lifetime information, you will miss it. In that case, if you see the structure, the spectral properties will change. There you will find the changes, lot of changes, and the intracellular environment also. But usually, if you attach with any molecules, you will give the prominent same emission wavelength. Some fluctuations, 1 or 2 nanometer, it's not going to affect much more. But there it should affect, depend upon the intracellular environment, depend upon the viscosity and the quenching and the pH ion exchange in the surrounding environment. Yes, the emission spectra will affect. Yes. Next question, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Yes, hello? Sir, that is another question. Could this microscopic technology is applicable in medicinal diagnosis? If yes, to which instrument it is equivalent?
In the case of medical diagnostics, In the case of medical diagnosis, now the people are coming with fluorescent techniques. A lot of fluorescent techniques are coming. But if you go with the tomography, PET and everything, that's a different type of imaging technique. That's only for medical purpose. Okay. But this is for the fundamental purpose. But nowadays, with the very recent development, the people are using to see the nucleus alterations. You can find the different shapes in the nucleus, for example, the cancer tissue. Very recently, I worked with the breast cancer tissues. from the Cancer Institute. We got a breast cancer people. So they have a slice of breast slice. So we found it, the nuclear size morphology will be changed within the malignancy or the tumor side compared to the regular cells. So this kind of identification, we can identify, okay, we can diagnostic the person is in this level of cancer level, we can go for diagnosis. So there are different applications out there. You can do it.
Okay. So that is a question from YouTube live stream. Mr. Abdul Wahid.
Nice.
More and more research is going on in drug design information, but we cannot control environmental impacts. Why, sir?
Environmental impacts, in the sense.
Maybe Mr. Abdul Wahid, can you please put your question in a more can you rewrite your question?
No, like I can answer the question in the another way. Like there are a lot of development. Why we are dying? This is the same question what he is asking. There is a lot of development. Why? We can try to stop the infection, but we can't remove the infection from the world. If you want to remove the infection, we have to go to the session of Adam and Eve, because it's not easy, because we contaminated the world in a very high way. So by using the term called the science. So again and again, once we are using the science, we are contaminating the world. That is true. This is the true answer. True answer. But still, we can try to survive by using the science. That's the one. But you can improve the drug, but you can't save it. You can stop for some time. That's the one. And again, I'm telling you, this is like a mechanism. The cells are energetic. You can see your kids. If they cut off the hands, the cells can grow within 2 days or something. But in our case, if we cut the hand things after 40 years or 30 years, it can take time, 4 or 5 days. Why? Because the regeneration ability of the cells will be changed depend upon the environmental condition, the age factor. And that's a different research of aging. So that's the same thing, immunity and everything.
Okay.
And it also is one of the immunity based disease only. If you are very stable with immune ability, yes, you can again the COVID. And the COVID is one of the very fundamental basic virus. It's not a very dangerous virus basically. But still, if you are not immune capable, if you are not, your immunity, your antibodies against to the virus or the vitamin deficiency, or the protein deficiency is there, yes, you will be affected. That's why there are a lot of death populations. This is more than 60 or more than 70 years old.
That is the last final question.
Please.
Can enzymes be used for specific heavy metal detection, sir?
Yes, there are matrix metalloproteinases are there. The people are using a lot of metals. I hope Dr. Sadeep can answer for this, because he's going to concentrate on all the metal-based fluorescence. I hope he will give you a good idea for that more than me. Yes, there are matrix metalloproteinases. There are a lot of things, and there are heavy metal based reactions are there a lot in the field. So you can do that. Yes.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
In the chat box, we can see so much of appreciation for your presentation and
your
talk. They say it is very informative and excellent presentation. Nice presentation. It's really a wonderful time we had. Thank you very much, sir. And